Good morning. What a stunning building and venue. I feel very at home. My office in San Francisco is actually an old pipe organ factory, which is an extraordinary machine, and there's one behind us. I'm Saul Griffith. I represent an organization called Rewiring Australia. I'm here to talk to you about the big switch, or as I explain it to my wife, my mission to turn Australia on to an abundance agenda of clean electrification, eliminating all of our emissions, lowering the cost of living, and improving the health of us and, most importantly, our children. As you know, we have an emissions problem. This is Australia's emissions problem. The big brown slice of the pie there is actually emissions that don't even go on our tab. That's the coal and the LNG that we export, and it's burnt elsewhere and goes on the emissions where it's burnt. The blue and white are the domestic economy. The white piece, however, is actually emissions that we incur here, like diesel taking all of that coal to port, like the cows that emit methane here. They shouldn't fart here, but they get eaten elsewhere, go on someone else's tab. The blue emissions are the real domestic economy. That's our homes, that's our cars, that's our businesses, it's our electricity grid. Of that domestic economy, more than 80% of our emissions are energy, coal, oil, gas, a little bit of agriculture for ourselves, a little bit of our landfill and waste, and a little bit of manufacturing. I'm a true energy nerd. This is one of my day jobs, is studying international energy and emission systems and looking at all of the flows through the economy from the left-hand side of that Sankey diagram, which is oil and coal and gas, solar and wind, all the way through the manufacturing and the processing and the transportation of those fuels in the middle, turning them into electricity, for example, and then all of the uses on the right, the things that we like to do, cook, drive, warm ourselves, take hot showers. Most people think of these as spaghetti diagrams, and I don't really want you to study them in detail. I want you to think of them the way I think of them, because I'm an engineer, I design machines for a living. I think about the machines underneath. The machines that run our electricity grid, the machines that run our homes, the machines that run our cars, the machines that run our commercial sector, our mining sector, our manufacturing sector, and our agricultural and even our industrial processing sectors like steelmaking, where I started my career. They technically call the big machines on the left the supply machines. There's about a million of those in the Australian economy. They're owned by corporations. They're financed by the public markets. On the demand side, there's many, many more machines. These are the machines that you and I own in our homes, in our small businesses. Let's have a look at the Australian economy as it is today. About 500 million tons of coal is mined every year. At about 100 mines, we've got thousands of these trucks. We have dozens of these coal loaders. We have tens of thousands of these coal trucks. We have thousands of diesel locomotives. We have 36,000 kilometers of freight rail. We have 24 coal-fired power plants fed by that, as well as our export facilities for exporting our coal. In addition, we mine 100 million tons of natural gas from 25 offshore rigs. We have thousands of gas fields, 39,000 kilometers of natural gas transmission across the country, 9 LNG terminals to send it overseas, 7 industrial gas storage facilities where we pump it underground to keep it for next week, and a few hundred gas-fired electricity generators to supplement our coal. In addition, there's about 100,000 kilometers, believe it or not, of gas distribution lines that bring that gas all the way to your home or your barbecue. We've got about 7 million homes with a gas meter, probably 500,000 commercial buildings with one as well. In addition, there's 1.5 million homes in Australia that use LPG tanks. All of that gas runs 6 million gas heaters, close to 5 million water heaters, close to 2 million ranges or uprights. In addition, nearly 3 million gas cooktops, 2.5 million gas ovens, even at least 10,000 fossil-fired hot tubs, too many fossil-fired swimming pools, and of course, what we all love is our fossil-powered barbecues. So many little blue flames that we now know are killing us, leading cause of respiratory illness, bad for your children and their asthma. That brings us to oil. 131 million barrels a year are produced in Australia, dwarfed by our imports, about 850 million barrels. That's powering our 20 million vehicles in our garages, a diminishing number of which are sedans, only about 35% now, 45% and growing are the big ones, the SUVs and the crossovers, 20% utes, and about a million motorcycles. There's an increasing number of dirt bikes and jet skis out there making noise, and then this is what ruins your Saturday morning in the suburbs, our plethora of lawnmowers, chainsaws, and leaf blowers, my wife's nemesis. Additionally, we've got golf carts, we've got ride-on lawnmowers, we've got 105,000 of these articulated trucks, we've got 97,000 buses, we've got 500,000 rigid trucks, we've got nearly 10,000 general aviation aircraft, we've got nearly 2,500 commercial jets, 6,500 petrol stations feeding all those machines, also selling you nicotine and sugar, three things that can kill you in one place, how convenient. Thousands of tanker trucks deliver that oil to them. We've got four, maybe only two now, oil refineries producing it all, connected by 3,600 kilometers of oil pipelines, and 60 oil tankers that deliver it to us because we have to import it all, zero of which are now Australian-owned or operated, which is a significant national security issue as well as a trade imbalance issue. In addition to all of those direct energy ones, we burn some fossil fuels in our dozen smelters and blast furnaces, and we have half a dozen cement factories that not only emit from the energy they produce, but from the creation of the clinker. So hopefully you were all counting and kept track. That was 101 million machines I just showed you. So I've named and shamed the problem with the Australian economy, except for this one. We also have 30 million machines producing beef and milk, and 104 million machines producing wool and tasty, tasty lamb. So here we are, 2022, 40 gigatons of emissions. This is the 1.5 degree emissions trajectory, so that's what we would like to achieve by 2030. Australia helped the world set the baseline year as 2005. We've done bugger all in reducing emissions from the energy industry since then. We've done a little better, or some might think we've cooked the books on the accounting for land use and forestry, so that's how we claim a little bit of emission reductions. But really the big job is to get to the X marks the spot in 2030. I'm delighted that we've announced 43%. It's a great start. It's not quite enough, but ambition begets ambition, and as we start to succeed on this project, I hope we ratchet this up. So, back to the machines. I've named and shamed them, the million big ones, the 100 million little ones. The honest story is we don't have replacements for a lot of the, you know, we don't have green ammonia yet, we don't have green steel yet, we don't have green hydrogen yet. Those things aren't going to give us the emission reductions we need on the left-hand side this decade. We need to focus on the demand side, the 100 million machines, if we're going to get those critical early emissions we need immediately. Nearly all of these machines need to be replaced in the next 20 years. So we're going to electrify everything. Not quite everything. We're going to use some of our forestry byproducts. We're going to use some bio waste. We're going to use some agricultural waste, some food waste, and some landfill. That'll help us create enough biofuels for some of the hard abatement sectors, like long-distance aviation, like long-haul trucking, some of our agricultural diesel, some of our diesel for our train. But everything else needs to be electrified. That is our strategy. That includes hydrogen. The only good hydrogen is green hydrogen. Green hydrogen starts with green electricity. But green hydrogen isn't going to do a lot in our domestic economy, so let's talk about our domestic economy. We've probably got to build 100 new pumped hydroelectric facilities, not necessarily new dams so much as storage. That'll be critical. We could, but it's incredibly unlikely, build nuclear. Particularly, even if we try, we're not going to have it in the ground on a time frame that is relevant to the emissions reductions that are required. We might, however, build some of these geothermal plants, but what we will do for sure, the heavy lifters are going to be 2,500 of these giant solar farms, about 100 megawatts, about 50,000 of these 3 to 5 megawatt wind turbines, about 5,000 of them we'll probably put offshore, and they will generate incredible energy in Australia's fantastic offshore wind industry. I'm a wind surfer, so I know it's there. We'll need 2,500 community batteries, one for every postcode. We'll need 2,000 kilometres of transmission. We'll need all of our distribution substations to be upgraded. We'll need to do a little work on our 1 million kilometers of distribution grid that you see in your local neighborhood. We'll probably need to upgrade or add a few of these 7 million power poles, and those little warts on the top, the distribution transformers, we'll need an upgrade, about 25,000 of those. That's the 1 million machines, but what about the other 100 million machines? That brings us back to our 10 million households. And I've got good news for you. The car on the left, that's either the Toyota Hilux or the Ford Ranger, Australia's two favorite trucks. About 80% of the petrol or diesel you put into it just goes up the smokestack as waste heat. That's why your engine block gets hot. The amazing thing about the electric trucks that are coming that you can now buy in the US and are starting to dribble in here is they're about 95% efficient. So they'll only use one third or maybe even less of the amount of energy to do the same kilometer as the truck on the left. Same is true of your heating systems. If you use reverse cycle AC, the heat pump on the right, it'll use only about one third of the energy of that gas heater on the left for the same amount of heat. Same is true of your water heater. Again, heat pumps versus gas will use a third or a quarter of the energy for the same amount of long, hot shower. Even your cooking will be more efficient when you go off gas. Modern induction, modern electric cooking, only about half the energy per meal of natural gas. The biggest saving of all is in the incredible wastefulness of our electricity system. Close to 70% of the coal and the gas that we feed into our electricity system is lost in those cooling towers as waste heat. When you generate wind power, when you generate solar electricity, you don't generate that waste. So here's the incredibly good news story. On the left, that's your average Australian household today, 102 kilowatt hours per day for all of your energy needs. The majority is on top, that's the petrol and diesel. There's a little bit in the middle, which is natural gas for your cooking and your heating. On the bottom, some natural gas and coal that's providing your electricity. If we electrify all of those 100 million machines that we own in our homes and small businesses, we'll go to 37 kilowatt hours per day, nearly a third. That's an enormous efficiency. So electricity and electrification is the efficiency we've been looking for since the 1970s. Here is an extraordinary chart. I'm very proud to say this chart helped us get Joe Manchin to sign the largest climate bill ever in the US, or we're nearly there, hopefully today or tomorrow. This shows you what happens with energy. The average Australian household over the last 30 years, you can see the total cost of all their energy, gas, petrol, and electricity, just goes up and up and up at a little bit faster than the CPI. That's the rate of inflation. And you can predict that that's going to continue for the next 20 years. The extraordinary miracle of renewables is we substitute finance for fuels. Yes, the wind machine or the solar machine costs a lot up front, but you finance it and you pay a flat rate for 20 years into the future. Any machine that you buy today that's electric and that you're powering off renewables has a fixed known cost of operation in the future. It's fossilflation free energy. That's going to lead to huge savings in our households and our suburbs, $3,000 to $5,000 a house. It's going to lead to a huge number of jobs. We might even decide to start manufacturing some things here again, or at least we'll do very well selling the metals and the ores to the world to make the batteries, the electric vehicles, the appliances, and the other things we need for this transition. It's going to make your children much healthier. It's going to make your communities much happier. And honestly, we're off to a great start. Australia leads the world. We have the lowest cost of rooftop solar energy. 3 million rooftops already have it. But we've got 10 million of these houses. So we've got 7 million houses to go for rooftop solar. But each of them will also need to electrify these critical machines. The 1.9 vehicles, the hot water heater, the heat pump for the heating systems, the kitchen, the roof, the battery, even the fuse box. And with those upgrades, we can get to zero machines. That's 101 million machines. It's about one machine every 10 seconds for the next 25 years. That's about six machines a minute. We can do it. That's the big switch. I'm Saul Griffith, and I hope you're going to go home from this thinking about every machine in your life. You probably bought a Volvo a few years ago. When it dies, I want you to buy an electric vehicle. When you're doing a kitchen reno, make sure it's all electric. When your water heater packs it in, make sure you go for a heat pump, And if every Australian household stays on schedule, that's how we achieve the emission reductions we need this decade. That's how we rewire Australia. Thank you very much.